In order to make any kind of choice, you could put it through a kind of mathematical model for figuring out what's the best decision to be made. And so maybe if you want to answer whether God exists or not, you might be able to put it into this model. Or maybe not whether God exists, you could at least figure out what you can decide about it. So decision theory can be really helpful for kind of making an advancement on this discussion. Decision theory is a theoretical approach for figuring out what are the best kinds of strategies for making good decisions, for maximizing outcomes, preventing risk, things like that. So this is often brought up in statistics for like, well, what are the odds that you need to, you know, go outside with an umbrella or not? But also it's going to be relevant for people who are doing models of economics, of psychology. All these different fields rely on decision theory. So let's consider the following scenario. Suppose you carry a lot of books and papers around 1 o'clock on some given day. You carry around a lot of books and papers. And then you look at the weather before you go out, and it says it's forecasted to downpour rain around 1 p.m. So you're thinking, gosh, I'm not sure that I want to carry my books and papers around if they're going to get wet. Maybe I should bring an umbrella. So the question is, should you bring an umbrella? Well, one way you can do it is to kind of like think about all the possible scenarios. You could talk about the probability that it's going to rain. You could talk about the probability that it's not going to rain. You could talk about what would happen if you bring an umbrella or if you don't bring an umbrella. So you could kind of calculate this in terms of like, well, if it rains and I bring an umbrella, then I'm okay. There's no loss. We're all good. But if it doesn't rain, then not only was I carrying around my books and papers, which is pretty cumbersome, I'm also bringing my umbrella, and that means I have like a minor annoyance of having to carry around an umbrella that I didn't actually get to use. But then I could still think about, well, what's the value of if I go and I don't have my umbrella? Well, that depends on if it rains or not. Well, if it rains and I left my umbrella at home, that's terrible. My books and my papers will get wet, things like that. It's really bad. So you could give it like a negative score. This is really, really bad. It's nowhere near as bad. I'm sorry. It's far worse as the minor annoyance of carrying around an umbrella. But this sounds like the thing that you want to ensure doesn't happen, right? But now if you leave your umbrella and it doesn't rain, then again, you're totally fine. So if it rains and you bring the umbrella, you're fine. If you leave the umbrella and it doesn't rain, you're fine. So now the question is, okay, should I make sure absolutely that I don't have to, you know, get wet at all by just making sure I have an umbrella? Like avoid that left square, left bottom square where everything's terrible. Well, I don't have to just think about like all the goods and the bads that can happen. I can also think about the probability that they're going to happen. If I think about the probability that it's going to rain, well, what if it's only 20% chance of rain? Then I have like a 1 in 5 chance that it's going to rain. And that means 4 out of 5 chance that it's not going to rain. That it's maybe just going to be clouds. But if that's true, now I can kind of discount how good not carrying the umbrella is and how bad not carrying the umbrella is when it doesn't rain and when it does. So if I kind of like discount each one by their probabilities, well, then I get, well, the same result if I bring the umbrella and the same result if I don't bring the umbrella when it doesn't rain. But notice, though, that my minor annoyance, I've discounted it. It's like only 4/5 as valuable as it was before. I gave it like a minor annoyance of -5. Well, I can discount that 1/5 chance off of the -5, making it -4. So basically, I'm giving that scenario less weight. I'm giving that bad case not as much weight. But then I'm doing the same thing as well for if I leave the umbrella and it rains. It's still pretty bad. It's still five times as bad as if I leave the umbrella and it rains, it's going to be still five times as bad. It's going to be negative 20. So even though it's really bad, I've discounted it by how it's not as likely to happen. So that means I'm dropping the expected terrible down to negative 20. Now, the whole point of this exercise is to say, okay, I can see now why there's a little bit of a tension. Sure, the choice is obvious when it comes to negative 100 versus negative 5. But now it's, even though it's more like, it's still leaning one way, it's obvious why I hesitate to bring the umbrella when it's only a 20% chance of rain. It's because the difference isn't so big. One, it's 20 times as bad, and the other, it's only 5 times as bad. Okay, I still probably want to avoid that terrible scenario, and I'll bring the umbrella anyway. But at least what I can do here is I can decide what is the best rational choice if I were to be talking about a different kind of scenario. Lots of different kinds of scenarios where I can kind of give a premium or discount a choice based off of how likely it's going to actually be that I land myself into that situation. One really fun case is to talk about the prisoner's dilemma. So imagine a case like this, where you and your friend are robbing a bank. So you and your friend rob a bank, and you guys have like masks on, you get away for a while, but eventually, you separate and you like store the cash somewhere and so on. And then like you're found, like, so the money's not found, but you're found with your gun on you and all the other stuff. And so you're taken back to the police precinct and they're just like, okay, we're pretty sure they robbed the bank. Okay, we're pretty sure they robbed the bank. We need to know the money and we need to be able to get a little bit more evidence. We need a little bit more proof. And so suppose they give you a deal. Suppose when you've been caught, you're taken to the precinct, you're given the following deal. If you rat out your friend, you say, yeah, my friend, he totally robbed the bank. They'll give you a deal. They'll say, hey, you get to go free. You don't get to do any jail time. You're fine. But your friend, they're gonna be in jail a long time. They're gonna be in prison. So you get off scot-free, but they get extra time because you ratted them out. You confessed. You're willing to give the police the information that they needed to get a conviction. But suppose that you keep quiet. If you keep quiet, if the other person keeps quiet too, then they'll still get you on a lesser charge. You'll still have to do some jail time because you have an illegal firearm. And so they will still give you some jail time, even if they can't give you get you for the bigger conviction of doing robbery. So your friend is caught and they're given the same deal as you. So they could rat you out too. And if they rat you out, then they go off scot-free and you get extra time. You are in prison for a lot longer. But if they keep quiet, again, they'll be caught on a lesser charge for the illegal firearm. Now, if you guys both rat each other out, you both still get some time. So now let's kind of like put this on that table again. So we can talk about the four different situations. You guys are separated. You guys don't know what each other is going to do. You don't know what each other is going to say. You don't know if they're going to rat you out. And they don't know if you're going to rat them out. So you could just like chart it out here. So if you rat them out and they rat you out, then you guys are both in jail for a year. But if your friends stay silent and you rat them out, then you're scot-free. You're out. You don't get any problem, but they get 5 years. So they get 5 years. You're off scot-free. If you can if you rat them out, but they stay silent. But if you stay silent and they rat you out, 5 years you're in prison, but they're off scot-free. Now, if you both stay silent, you're both going to be caught on that lesser charge of having an illegal firearm. So you're both going to get 6 months. So if you're going to be working through this, now think about, what would you do? What would you do? Would you rat them out or not? Because if you rat them out, you could still get caught because they could rat you out too. If you're just like, I'm just going to be quiet. Then you'll have like 6 months, but it's not going to be a year, and it's definitely not 5 years. But then if you keep quiet, man, if they rat you out, you're screwed. You're there for 5 years. If you stay silent, they're off scot-free, but you're there for 5 years. So are you going to stay silent, or are you going to rat them out? Now, you could have a variety of different strategies in order to try to answer this problem. You might just be able to say, okay, I'm just going to ignore what my friend does. And I'm just going to say, if they rat me out, is there a good decision? Like, what's the best decision if they rat me out? The best decision if they rat me out is not for me to stay silent. If they rat me out, the way for me to get the fewest years possible is for me to rat them out. But, what's the best decision if they stay silent? How can I get the least amount of time if they stay silent? If they stay silent, I could get off scot-free. If they stay silent, I could get off free. And that's way shorter time than 6 months. So it seems like whether your friend rats you out or not, the way for you to get the least amount of time is for you to rat them out. So this is what might be called a dominant strategy. Irrespective of what the other person does, your decision can be made either way as getting you the least amount of time. But obviously, if you guys are both being rational and you guys are both being selfless, you'll both stay silent. You won't rat each other out. So basically, the dominant strategy seems to be rat them out. But if you're selfless, that actually works out the best for you and your partner at the same time. You're both only in there 6 months. You're not like in there together for more than a year. You're not there for 5 years. They're not in there for 5 years. Like, so the best amount of time for both of you is for both of you to stay silent. So are you going to try to avoid the worst situation? Are you going to aim for the best and just hope that they're thinking the same way? What you're going to do? Now, this whole setup is supposed to help you think through, if you know all the possible situations, even if you don't know the way it's going to play out, you can still make a decision based off of what is either going to reduce your suffering or improve your odds of getting a good situation. Or you could just say, well, what is the best decision no matter what happens? What's the best decision no matter what happens? And the best decision might be to rat them out. So can you make a decision without knowing what your partner's going to do? So do you rat your friend out or do you stay silent? That's like the punchline of this. Now, this can be made into more and more complicated puzzles depending on like if you have like had really good experiences with this person before. Like they know to stay silent over and over and over so you can trust them. Or if you change the numbers, like if it gets radically different, man, the costs are way higher if you end up staying silent. So you can monkey with the numbers quite a bit. You can have several different trials. You can add additional persons. And this is game theory and a huge part of what is developed in decision theory.